Hey guys, in this video I attempt the Lone Wolf Challenge in Spore. Fresh out of the cell stage, Spore shows us the advantages of working together as a team. Protection from predators, hunting, acquiring resources, and increased chances of finding a mate. But this isn't always the case. Many solitary species on Earth were able to thrive without reliance on others. Even within our own culture, brave heroes emerged, such as Bear Grylls, Ray Mears, and COVID, who taught us how to survive independently. But which is the most effective method for survival? To find out, I turn to everyone's favorite evolution simulator, the 2008 classic Spore. The Lone Wolf Challenge rules stipulated by Reddit were simple. Complete the creature stage without adding any creatures to your pack. To ensure survival, my hero had to possess omnivorous traits, enabling them to consume whatever sustenance crossed their path. Maintain camouflage and concealment, whether evading danger or stealthily ambushing prey. Possessing curvaceous, firm yet sensitive buttocks to enhance its likelihood of attracting a mate. Our purple, smooth-bodied protagonist, Derriere Grylls, emerged from the tide pool, immediately left the nest and sought adventure in the bush. To evolve, Derriere had to impress another species or destroy them. Anyway was game, as long as he did it alone. Our first tactic was to use those voluptuous buttocks to distract another species, allowing us to get in close. Then, we disorientated our opponents using the fluid motion of our flagella. As our opponents stared down our long proboscis into Derriere's mesmerizing stare, we sang a mysterious song to the Chukan, who was powerless to resist. However, this Chukan was only a starter creature, easy to defeat and malleable to our charms. More difficult challenges would await. Derriere ventured further from his home, collecting as many bone piles as possible from the surrounding nests and unlocking upgrades for our species, using our camouflage to sneak silently through the undergrowth. If we got too close, other species would become alerted and attempt to find us, indicated by the exclamation mark. We had to keep moving, sifting through the piles of bones near their nests. The more parts we found, the more opportunities we could have for powerful evolutionary upgrades, increasing our chances of survival. We remained cautious for now, choosing to interact with more basic, impressionable creatures while we grew in strength. As our brains grew, Spore allowed us to form a pack with others, but Derriere was a strong, independent Derriere. As we found more evolved creatures, we were no longer able to generate enough social points to win dance-offs. To remain competitive, we needed to evolve, by returning to our great nesting grounds to reproduce. Others in Derriere's species would suggestively shake their buttocks. Only those with the roundest butts won the opportunity to mate. The process of evolution took its course, with new mouthparts forgoing bite strength for an improved social song. His flagella evolved into a single forearm. His feet became better at dancing. He gained hooked claws to strike his foes to compensate for his lack of bite. Despite his evolution, his sumptuous rump was not to everyone's taste, sparking some aggression. Yet with only his single newly developed forearm, his buttocks were his preferred method of discovering and interacting with the world around him, sensitive and tactile. But not all creatures he found were friendly. Peaceful interactions were the easiest way to survive. Fighting a whole nest of creatures would be suicide on our own, but in the case of an aggressive species, necessity demanded we fight. Using the sneak ability gave us an excellent opportunity to observe and study our prey. We lured a lone straggler out into the open, away from its nest. Then, when it was far enough away from its group, we pounced. This was a slow and methodical process. We could only afford to fight one predator at a time. Even then, each battle left us close to death. The blessing of our omnivorous mouthparts was that we could devour its body and regain some strength. One by one, we picked them off. They would never know the face of their attacker, as their numbers dwindled one by one before becoming extinct. The process continued, and Derriere sought a mate. Evolving, increasing in strength. A game of cat and mouse ensued. Even as we became stronger, other creatures around us evolved and began socializing in groups, making our lives more difficult. The more creatures that danced, the stronger they accumulated points in the dance-off. Even with the most impressive body upgrades equipped, we couldn't withstand social power of that magnitude. To have any chance of winning, we had to reduce the number of opponents we faced. Derriere worked to isolate lone creatures, enticing them away from the nest, then, on the quiet shores of a beach, exposing himself. This new tactic worked well. They even survived a mass extinction event as his lord and savior Spode attempted to cleanse the planet of life. Like clockwork, Derriere returned to the nesting grounds once more to mate. Evolving, becoming stronger, before going out on the hunt again, like a boogeyman waiting in the shadows, a nightmare to scare young children from leaving the nest. The eyes, the butt. As long as he didn't take on more than one of the stronger creatures at a time, else he risked being run out of town. But smaller creatures like the annoying Beaky he had grown to deal with, which a passing Frogmaster thanked him for, a testament to his growing strength. Eventually, our Derriere was no longer a creature of the shadows, but an apex predator, able to handle multiple hostile creatures, one after the other. Derriere had come a long way, and in Reddit's eyes, the challenge was complete. Or was it? Would it be possible to solo the tribal stage? I was doubtful. The next stage in Spore specializes in growing a society, cooperating or dominating. How would our clan of solo hunters survive? From this point on, we prioritized hunting worthy opponents. The hunt became a sacred ritual. We would choose prey carefully and take great pride in the hunt's success and our desire to prove ourselves as skilled hunters. They wore fearsome new masks to strike trepidation into their opponents, but also covered their eyes, making navigation difficult. On a positive note, they had made tools, sticks, and staffs to scratch their butts. They were ready to try socializing with a neighboring tribe, which went as well as expected. Derriere tried to fight the beetles. Things started well as he attempted to pick off the surrounding tribesmen, but the only weapon he had was a ranged spear. The beetles soon outnumbered him, forcing him to retreat, dragging back half of the beetle village. Equalizing the odds was a requirement, and soon part of Derriere's honor code. The hunt should be a fair contest between two worthy adversaries. As such, they took great care to ensure the odds were equal between themselves and their prey. This meant reducing beetle numbers, but only when they attacked our village. Derriere then robbed their food stores, disabling their ability to replenish their numbers, equalizing the odds. We returned to a nearby water source and hooked fish from the river to gain food. At the same time, one of our lone warriors took an opportunity to kick one of the beetles' tents before being chased off. Then, while distracted with their tent, Derriere stole their food. While Derriere's village attempted to be social, it was useless. There needed to be at least two villagers to complete a tribal dance-off, one to direct and one to play an instrument. There was no choice but the hunt. New villagers emerged on the scene, to whom we bought gift baskets of food to placate them before making a swift exit, as an epic beetle ate their village. Making peace with the other tribes allowed us to deal with each on our own terms. The beetles made another move, attempting to raid our village, but with their attack thwarted, their food stolen, and their villagers dead, we sent in our lone warrior, who sought to prove themselves as worthy members of the clan. If they survived their hunts, they might one day become clan chieftains themselves. We had a short window to do as much damage as possible before a new beetle chieftain arrived. Unable to win against the chieftain one-on-one, it prompted our retreat. The beetle chieftain then came to the Derriere village, and so we killed him. Then sent a single warrior to his village in return, and so the cycle continued. Despite us stealing all the beetles' food, they could always create at least one villager, meaning it was either impossible to steal all a villager's food, or they slowly generated food regardless. Either way, despite our loss, we were avenged by an epic beetle, who was then swiftly killed by a single genocidal herbivore. Don't mess with those guys, I'm telling you. The cycle of chieftains and single warriors continued until eventually we defeated the beetle village. Sending only one warrior to battle had its advantages. It allowed the rest of the tribe to focus on gathering food and protecting the village from wild animals and tribal attacks. The next village was the Cyans. A single warrior was sent to cause trouble, chucking a spear at their chieftain. The Cyans were initially slow to respond, eventually sending a single warrior to steal our food. We responded in kind, stealing their food, an eye for an eye. The cycle repeated itself. We provoked an attack. We defeated the attack. We stole their food. Eventually, the time was right for a single warrior to prove himself to the tribe, until finally, the Cyans were defeated. Next, the Pinks. As had been done many times before, we came, we stole, they came, we killed. And with the technology of flaming torches we had discovered from the Cyans, we sent our lone warrior to attack the Pink structures until enough time had passed for the Pinks to grow another villager or chieftain. The difficulty with this challenge was, after retreating, the speed at which the enemy could repair and heal their tribesmen, meaning any damage we had done with our single villager was soon repaired by the time we returned. Yet still, we persevered. Yet let it be known that a derriere could also know peace. We singled out a lone villager from the Green Tribe to see if we could befriend them without the social power of the rest of their tribe. Yet this was also a failure. Then, the Orange Tribe turned up. We appeased them with fruit baskets and kind words, and then stole it back again to prove how alpha we were. The Oranges retaliated. They came. We killed. But the Oranges were smarter than this, reluctant to send another raid to our meat grinder, instead retreating to their village every time we goaded them with spears and angry butts. But as always, we persevered, allowing our single warrior to begin proving himself. We came. They defended. They came. We killed. Over and over, slowly, until finally, only one tribe remained, some genocidal vegetarians. After outfitting ourselves with the most robust tribal gear, we fought again. They were robbed. They were killed. Before sending in our single warrior to prove his worth, now armed with a hatchet axe, we liberated from the Orange Tribe. We were now even more effective in one-on-one combat. With our solitary path, we had conquered every obstacle that stood in our way. Alone, we faced the trials and tribulations that life threw at us. But as we stood amidst the remnants of our battles, Derriere couldn't help but acknowledge the undeniable truth. Despite our fierce independence, his victories wouldn't have been possible without the fleeting moments of connection and camaraderie. And so, as we gazed upon the horizon, he honored not only his own journey, but also the silent bonds that bound us together. Warriors, united by the shared understanding that even in the midst of our solitary conquest, we were never truly alone.